and welcome to one and all. It is indeed a pleasure and privilege for all of us today to have Mr. Mansoor Khan with us here on behalf of Department of Electronic Media and Mass Communication and Department of Economics. I extend a very warm welcome to Mr. Mansoor Khan. I would also like to request Professor P. Muthayan, Head of Department of Economics, to honor the chief guest. Mr. Mansoor Khan is an alumnus of IIT Mumbai, Cornell University, and MIT Boston. He started his career as a filmmaker and went on to make 4 feature films that won several national awards. In 2003, he moved to Kunur to realize his life's vision of building an organic farm that was self-sustaining and local. Spread over 22 acres, Acres Wild plays host to all those interested in a close-to-nation experience. The third curve is the outcome of Mansoor's own journey, an intricately researched piece of work that examines the correlation between the compulsions of economic growth and the limits imposed on us by nature. Questioning the efficacy of the modern industrial world, the third curve unfolds truths that civilization might perforce have to accept, not merely as a possibility, but as a way of life. I would now like to request Mansoor Khan to deliver his address.
Thanks to your dean and the faculty and my friend Dharmesh for making this happen. I want to assure you that this lecture is first of all, not moralistic. So we are not pointing fingers at anyone. You know, we have enough moral talk going on of how we are ruining this planet and all sorts of stuff. Most talks are normally about that these days. You know, so people misunderstand that my talk is also about some kind of moral hazard that we are causing. I just want you to keep in mind that my talk is about only possibility. What is going to be possible and what is not going to be possible. If you can just keep morality out of your head, throw it out of the room in fact, and just think that the talk is only saying, is this going to be possible or is this not going to be possible? And what is that thing that is going to be possible? It'll become evident in a second. So the talk is called The Third Curve. You must be aware of that. That sounds a little abstract, but you'll understand why it's called The Third Curve. But it's about the end of growth. So in short, I'm saying, is growth going to be possible? Now, when anybody uses the word growth in this world, which runs on economic principles, you know what kind of growth I'm talking about. It's financial growth, economic growth, industrial growth. And I don't mean qualitative growth. I don't mean the kind of growth that like you love your country more, you love your parents more. Not qualitative growth, that you love your children more, that you become better at playing the piano. I don't mean that kind of growth. You have to keep in mind that I mean quantitative growth and the kind of growth as we know it, you know, the way we have defined it. So that's just to put it in perspective so you know what I'm going to talk about. So again, it's not about morality, it's whether it's going to be possible to keep growth going the way we have defined it. So let's start with a little prelude. We'll step back to look. Very, very interesting things have happened over the last 3 phases, I would say, of modern industrial society. The first phase was when I was probably 10 years old. I was born in 58. So when I was 10 in around 68. We thought that the sky was the limit. Everything was possible. Our civilization was doing amazing things. You know, we had transatlantic flights, we had trains that were going faster, we had electronics, we had surplus food production, we felt like the food is never going to be a problem. We were apparently conquering diseases, malaria, tuberculosis, etc., etc. And we imagined that finally, you know, man is just going to conquer all these problems. And it's just a question of time. That we won't even need to do any work. There'll be robots serving us, and you can go for a holiday on Mars, and just come back and do things like that. But just when we got very, very complacent in this illusion of ours, something happened. There were little dots that appeared on the horizon, which were a little unsettling. So I remember we heard it first as the whale is disappearing. That was the extent of it, you know, that the whale is disappearing. So everybody was after saving this whale, the whales. Then the polar bear was disappearing. Then something else was. And these little dots collected on the horizon, our rivers were drying. The soil was getting polluted. There was chemicals in it. forests were going, something else is happening, and finally global warming. And all these little dots suddenly added up to a big picture, which we started recognizing as ecological collapse. So the first paradise times, what I call, was up to the 60s. Now, from where do I start measuring it? I start measuring it from 1850, somewhere there, okay? Early 19th century. And up to the 60s, it was paradise times. The second phase, which started and almost surprised us, we never thought that this was going to happen. We thought we were on our way to the stars. But suddenly something else happened. And so we said, okay, let's save this. Let's save our forests, let's save our rivers, let's save the panda, let's save the whale. We started these well-intentioned organizations and pumped in funds to make them run. And where did we generate those funds from? Where did we generate that money from to run those organizations? We got it from our industrial world, from our normal economic world, from our jobs, our productivity, our factories, our whatever. But suddenly we got another surprise. And we found that that itself was in trouble. The what you generated your funds with, what I call your inside, this was the outside. This is that stuff out there called forests and rivers and wild and all that. This is the inside, this is where we live. Our cities, our roads, and our schools and our hospitals. But suddenly we found that this was also in trouble. And you can see that from the late 90s. We have been in perpetual bubbles and collapses, which people are treating as separate bubbles. Oh, that was just the Asian crisis. Oh, that was just the dot-com bubble. Oh, that was just the subprime crisis. But there was a connectivity, not only amongst those bubbles, but there was a deeper connectivity between all these three phases. Why was this leading to this leading to this? This is what I want you to keep in mind. What is the connection between them? And the connection is what is really important to know if you have to think of what to do. 1850 started this concept. The concept of perpetual growth never existed before 1850. You ask anybody in, especially I'm going to talk from the point of view of economics, because I'm in the economics department. When I go to physics guys, I speak a little bit from their perspective. When I go to management guys, I speak a little bit from their perspective. But let's talk about it from the economic perspective. We take that as a religion. Growth is a religion. It's a given. It's like gravity. You can't say there's no growth. The moment you say there's no growth, everybody starts going nuts. And that's what's happening right now. So we got conditioned into believing from 1850, which never existed before, the idea that you have to just continuously have growth. Your cars get more, bigger. The cities get bigger. Your number of production of items, consumption, your GDP, your everything has to grow. Growth is our religion. It started in 1850. What caused it to start in 1850, I'll explain in a minute. But let's look at what we mean by growth, okay? And what are the elements that go into it? Say, for instance, we have a mind and we have a body. This is our mind, this is our body. Now to do anything which is worthwhile, your mind comes up with the concept first. So first the mind says something that the body has to do before you can say that that concept has been realized. Whether it be making something, lifting something, a service, or whatever, writing a book, making a movie, whatever it may be. But the concept is something that the mind does and body has to do reality. You think of lifting up a glass. So obviously you thought of it first and then you lift it up. It's light enough, it's small enough, it fits in your hand. Therefore that concept has been realized. Okay? I want you to keep in mind that whenever I talk about the mind, I write in red. Anything that you see in red is the mind, connected to the mind, with concepts. And anything you see in green is connected with reality, the body. Okay, this is very important for us to keep that in, you know, all the time throughout. Once more, your mind thinks of something more because we're into growth, right? We want to progress. We want to lift up something heavier. So we think of lifting up a chair. And my body is able to do that. And then I go through various things. I think of lifting this up, I think of lifting that, and maybe I achieve all that. And finally, I say, why not lift this up? Now it's very simple. I mean, you say, what a childish example to give, but it's important to understand that while we thought we could lift up heavier and heavier things, there was obviously a point, there was a limit that my body could do, and there are no limits to the mind. The mind can continuously think of more and more quantitative goals. But the body sets the limit for it. And the body has to realize it, because if the body doesn't do it, your concept is useless. You might as well have not thought about it. So this is the limits of the body of an individual. But obviously, we're not here to talk about individual limits. We are here to talk about something much bigger. But it's important to understand the correlation between concepts and reality, mind and body. So I would ask you the question, do you think there's anything that you know that can grow forever on this planet? Answer is money. So we think money grows forever. That is what we define as the basis of our economic system. It doesn't. It'll reach its limits after some time. There's only so much stuff you have, you know, on the planet to make technology out of. So it's money. So here we have, I'll give you one more example. Here's a coach and a runner. Again, a mind and body example. The coach, it's in red. The coach has a concept and the runner wants to fulfill that concept. The coach has a super concept. He's a super coach, you know, he's got a mind-blowing concept. And his concept is that he can make the runner break the sound barrier. And the sound barrier, by the way, is 1,200 kilometers per hour. So obviously the runner is thrilled because who wouldn't want to do that? It would be very glamorous, very... So if I'm the runner, like I don't believe him. So I say, how the hell are you going to make me do that? So he says, it's very simple. Can you run at 10 kilometers per hour? So I say, yes. He says, can you run 7% faster than that, which is 10.7? I say, yes. He says, well, can you run 7% faster of this, your earlier speed? 11.45, I say yes. He says 7% faster of that the next week, 12.25. Every week he's increasing it by 1.7% of the earlier week. I say yes. He says, well, then in just 70 weeks, you'll be running at the speed of sound, which is just 1.5 year. Now that sounds crazy. I say, wow, 1.5 year, it's amazing. How can I do that? How can I do it, especially because after the first 10 weeks, my speed has only increased up to 19.67. It has gone in the first week from 10.7, 11.45, 12, 13, 14, and something, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. Literally only 1 kilometer per hour increase every week. So how on earth am I going to be able to achieve? 10 weeks have already gone out of 70. There are only 60 left. Once 1/7 is gone, how can I do that? Because my graph looks like this. In 10 weeks, it looks pretty flat. And this scale is only 200. I have to go up to 1,200. So I don't believe him. I said, how am I going to do that? He says, you just have to continue doing whatever I told you to. He says, if you continue doing that, then look what happens after the 10th week. In the next, at the end of the 20th week, it becomes 38. I hope you guys are recognizing a pattern here. It's doubling every 10 weeks. At the end of 30th week, it becomes 76. Do the maths. At the end of the 40th week, it becomes 149. Then it becomes 294. 579, 1139, because you're compounding it. I'm just trying to show you how dangerous compounding is. You can say it very easily. We'll just give you 7% interest every year and compound it. But look, it looks like this. In this case, it just means that you've told a runner that he can achieve an impossible feat, but in simple steps. So if you look at the first 10 weeks, it looks like, of course I can do it, you know? So this is what his curve looks like. This is what he managed in the first week, and this is what his body has to fulfill every 10 weeks after that. And if you notice, the gap, the vertical gap is increasing. This segment is increasing. And if you do powers of two, you'll realize that very soon it'll go out of the atmosphere in less than 10 more doubling times. This is called the exponential curve. What the coach actually did with that little trick was that he has defined an exponential curve. And it goes up really fast, and it has no limits. But because I want to try it, I say, okay, let me do it. So the coach, this is his curve, okay? This is his desired speed curve. And I start following him. Every week, he increases it by 7%, and 7%, and 7%. For the first 10 weeks, I'm able to do it. Because my body, which is the green curve, is able to follow the red curve, the mind curve is demanding, the body curve is able to follow. Because both are in sync, I call it phase one and I call it paradise times. That means I'm happy. I can do what my coach is telling me to do. But after point one, and even if you look at the numbers, something happens. The next week I cannot increase my speed by 7% and I increase it only by 6.5% because my body cannot meet that rate of growth. And the week after that, when he pushes me more and more, Forget 6.5, it drops down to 5.5. That means last time it dropped by 0.5, now it's fallen by 1. So the rate of decrease of my speed is also falling. And the differential between his expectation and my body speed is increasing. He pushes me even further. I stop sleeping. I train 18 hours a day or 20 hours a day. I don't go and meet my friends. I become a loner. I start taking steroids. No matter what I do, I start taking supplements. I take extra sugar. I don't know what else I do. Whatever I do, my body slows down. That's how bodies behave. You can try it with yourself or anybody. And finally, at the end of phase two, you have reached the maximum point of your body. You are running faster. There's no doubt that I'm running faster each week, but the speed of increase is dropping until it reaches something which I call the peak. It is zero increase. I'm running the fastest I ever have, but my body is immensely stressed and it cannot increase any further. This I call the end of phase two. Phase one, paradise times, both the curves go together, mind and body. Mind says, I want this much. Body says, sorry, I can only give you this much. And when it reaches the maximum, because the whole point was to increase speed, and now the speed is not increasing, we have reached the end of phase two. Now, what do you think is going to happen after that? This is the differential. He says I should be running there, but actually I'm running here. There's a differential between the reality and his concept. What do you think will happen beyond this point? The more he trains me, the more he pushes me, the more he stresses me, what do you think will happen to my speed? It'll fall. So the more I take steroids, the more I train for 23 hours and 23 and a half hours a day, it's not going to make any improvement of performance. That's common sense. So I enter into phase three, which I call body collapse. Which I call concept collapse. This was body collapse because my body was getting stressed. This is concept collapse. That means the very concept that he had made is in collapse because I'm going the other way. He's saying go up and I'm going down in speed. So we see three phases of growth. When you have a concept which is exponential, your demand is exponential. But the reality that makes that possible is a bell curve. Can you not see how the two curves, how the two shapes, how they interact? For some time, they go together. The second part, one falls behind. But it's still going in the same direction at least. But in the third phase, it's not even going in the same direction. It's going in the opposite direction. So you get three phases of growth. Here the growth is true, because whatever the coach says I'm doing, here the growth is false, and here the growth fails. This is just for an individual. Now we'll just come to see what this means to the ultimate concept of growth, which I told you was money. Because we're not considered with runners. We're not concerned with runners, but this is going to matter. And you'll see, oh my God, there's a hell of a lot of correlation between a runner's body and the earth's body. So here's money. The ultimate concept that our minds could come up with. Remember, money is a concept. How many of you eat money for breakfast? None of you. But you eat bread, right? So bread is the true stuff. We call money bread. That's how deluded we are. But bread is what you eat. And 10 rupees with which you buy the bread is a representation of the value of the bread. So money is not value itself. Money is supposed to represent value. Okay? But we really believe that money is value. We now only talk in terms of that. So money comes from the mind of the financial system. Money is a map. Okay, it maps value. So we allowed the first concept. We said, let there be money that represents value. And we called it the first concept. I just want you to keep in mind that every time there's a red circle, it is a concept. Okay, so this is the first concept, or rather the first law of the economic system. So first you have to think of money as a measure of value, and you say this is the first law. Money is equal to value. So if I go to work, I work 8 hours a day. Whatever work I do, somebody gives me, say, 100 rupees a day. So that I go back home and I collect it. Say I collect it for a long time, and I've got now 10 lakh of these tokens which represent the work that I've done. And I keep those 10 lakhs under my bed. But I have a friend. Again, I'm going to use your name, Dharmesh, if you don't mind. I have a very enterprising friend, Dharmesh, here. He makes excellent cakes. In case you guys want to buy cakes from his shop, I'll give you the address later. So he makes such good cakes that everybody's buying the cakes that he makes. He makes 100 cakes a day. But now, all those cakes are going and getting sold. So what does he need to do? He needs to make more cakes, because people in Auroville and Pondicherry and everywhere are running after him and saying, please make more cakes. Now to make more cakes, he needs more sugar, more flour, more labor, more electricity, more space, whatever you call it. So to make more of it, what does he need? He needs capital. So he comes to me, because I'm a lazy guy, I put my 10 lakhs in, under the bed, and I don't do anything with it. He comes in and tells me, look, if you keep 10 lakhs under your bed, it's going to remain 10 lakhs. But if you give me the 10 lakhs, then I will give you 7% return at the end of the year. What is that called? It's called something else also. It's called time value of money. So what we've attached, the other concept that we've attached straight away to money is that money has time value. Money is like a ticking bomb. It can't just be 10 lakhs. It has to grow. That is the beginning of the second concept that says money is for interest. We call it interest. But in terms of explaining what it is supposed to do, it is supposed to have time value is what you mean. Money can't sit still. It has to earn interest. If you don't, you're a fool. That's what the world tells me. And that's what, not in such harsh words, but Dharmesh told me. He says, if you keep 10 lakhs under your bed, it'll only remain 10 lakhs. So he takes that 10 lakhs, he buys more flour, he buys more sugar, he buys more labor, labels, this thing, that thing, whatever he needs, and he makes more good cakes. He's making a genuine product. He's not cheating. He is making, he's definitely enterprising, he's hardworking, and he's making a good product, the cakes, and he increases the number of cakes from 100 to, say, 150. He earns 14% profit on it, 7% he keeps for himself, and 7% he gives me. I'm just trying to show you guys, I know you all are from the economics department, and right now you must be wondering, why is this guy from IIT and ex-Bollywood and all that kind trying to tell us the most fundamental laws of economics? Sometimes it is very important to revisit the fundamentals to find out. Oh, okay. Okay, sorry, I thought most of them were, somebody told me that they're most from the economics department. No? But everybody needs to know that. I feel we still need to visit, how did we come up with these concepts? So that looked like this. So I was very happy. I was already very happy that Dharmesh is going to give me 70,000 every year. And that looks like a linear a graph going up. So I'm very happy, 70,000 every year, and I'm thinking like how it's going to grow. But the next year, he doesn't return the 70,000 because his business is expanding. More people are coming to him. So he says, Mansoor, don't take this 70,000 interest back, and I will give you. So why I'm taking you through these baby steps is to show you that he's not a cheat. His fundamental idea is not something which is false. His fundamental idea is to make more products, which are good. But he's making an assumption. And that assumption I'll come to in a minute. So he says, if you leave the 70,000, I will give you 7% on that 10,70,000. Why does he keep the 70,000 back? So that he can buy more stuff and expand his business. So it follows naturally that we naturally fell into the trap of believing that we should expand our businesses if they do well. But the problem is that this, if not the problem, but he convinced me with this, he says, now your money is going to grow like this. Now, can you not see what a huge difference there is between this shape and this shape? Just take a look at that. This one doesn't even touch the right side of the page. When my money was growing like this, I was reaching the right side of the page, and only at this height. But the way my money is growing now, with just the third concept, only three concepts we have pulled out of our mind for money growth. And the third concept is insane. And he takes me through those steps, and I say, wow, now you can keep my 10 lakhs and just keep giving me whatever you're doing, this thing called compounding interest. And that's how we started believing in compounding interest. And we said, it has no limits. It's too good. Why should I question it? That's how we define the money curve. Right now, we're talking only about money. Remember, we have to deal with something else. Will you get more sugar? Will you get more cakes? Will you get more flour? Will you get more labor? Will you get more? The resources we haven't even thought of. We're just so happy that money is going to grow like this that we accepted it and said, wow, this is great. This is a law. And so we automatically added the next ring to create the money onion. I call it an onion because it's layers of concepts. Like just like an onion has layers and layers and layers, it seems like it has infinite layers. You keep peeling it and there's another layer. This is the other way around. We are creating the layers. As we need it, we create more layers. Money is equal to value, time value, compounding, perpetual growth. We pulled out four concepts from our mind because it made sense to us. And our world seemed to work that way. Why did it seem to work? Because when he wanted to expand it, he said, I need more eggs. The egg guy could give him more eggs. He said, I need more sugar. The sugar guy could give him more sugar. But he's going to reach a limit at some point, but we'll come to that later. But anyway, we defined something called the money onion, which is layers of concepts, which all came from the mind. And to me, this looks dangerous, but it looks too tempting. Why does it look so tempting? Because we all know, and that's what he told me, that I've given him 10 lakhs. At 7%, it doubles. 7% compounding interest, it doubles every 10 years. And my 10 lakhs in just 10 decades become 100 crores. Why would I work? Why would I do anything? It's going to become 100 crores. The shape looks like this. It's 1,024 times what I gave him. Now, doesn't this curve look very similar to the other curve we had seen? Where have you seen this curve before? Just today, just now. It was what the super coach said. The super coach said the same thing which Dharmesh told me. And it looks flat in the beginning and boom, it goes to the sky. Just try doing it. It's 100 crores there. Just try doing it for one more decade. 200 crores. What's bad about it? Just one more decade. 400 crores. Absolutely amazing. But what nobody tells you is that while your money is following or supposed to follow this pattern, so does the resources. And there is direct proof for it. Here it is. Has any department shown you this? Has anyone in your schooling ever shown you this correlation? No or yes? No. Why not? My question to any institute would be, why have we kept this a secret? This is like a CIA secret, an FBI secret. You know, is this supposed to be a secret? That nobody knows this. They teach you everything else. They teach you Max Planck's theory. They teach you Einstein's E = mc². They teach you about, you know, all sorts of things. Why was this not known, that if you have to make money grow like this, your energy consumption is also like this? It is in lockstep. And which one do you think is making which one grow? Is money making energy grow? Is energy making money grow? Energy is making money grow. It's only with the extra energy that he can get the sugar, get the flour, get this thing, get the labor, build the building, make the packaging, send it, the refrigeration, the bills, everything. It has to be energy that makes money grow. It cannot be money that makes energy grow. So here we are. This is the problem. So up till now, we made those rules. We made those four rules and said perpetual exponential quantitative growth. That's the name that growth should have. When the finance minister tells you, I'm going to get growth back, or the next person who's standing for prime minister tells you, I'm going to get growth back, you should actually catch hold and do a PIL against him. Because it's not growth that he's talking about. He's talking about perpetual, exponential, quantitative growth. It's a different monster. There's a huge difference between the word growth. You grow, don't you? But do you grow perpetually? Do you grow exponentially? You don't. So we are fooled into thinking that all growths are the same and as harmless. So that's what he means. But how did it start? How did this start that we could do this? It started with oil. That's why 1850. 1850 was when oil was used industrially. The Red Indians, or rather the Native Americans, knew about oil a long time back. Coal was 1750. But it was never used industrially. And this is the source of energy that we are talking about. This is the body that has to do the work. You remember the coach and the runner? Coach came up with any idea, but who has to do it? The runner. And what does the runner use to run? He uses energy. So the correlation is very similar. Now we come into the real part, which is the energy that runs your modern industrial world is oil. And that's the pattern that you want. Let's see how that fares. So it is one thing to make plans from your mind, like you go to your father and you tell him, this is what I'm going to do, so please give me 10 lakhs. But he wants to know how you're going to do it. Now, where is that energy or resources come from? There's only one place that we get it from. That's the earth, and the earth is finite. It gives the illusion that it is very big, and it gives us the feeling that the earth is infinite. But sorry, the earth is finite. But it's not finiteness that is the problem. There is something else about the earth, the second point that our education system does not teach us, and that is how the earth behaves. Forget the finiteness. We all know the earth is finite. But how does the earth behave? All resources that you get from the earth behave in a bell curve. How many of you knew this? None. It's a scientific fact. It's an empirical fact. Why is this the second biggest secret that has been kept? What is the amount of money that an average student spends to go through education? Doesn't he deserve to know this? So don't you think that it is being consciously being kept away? And he says, no, come on, we don't need to teach people that the earth behaves in a bell curve. We can teach them everything else. You teach them astronomy, you tell them what's happening on Pluto, you try to tell them about the God particle, for heaven's sake, which doesn't even matter. But we don't tell them this most fundamental fact. I want you guys to think about it. I'm not blaming any faculty or any system. It is an intriguing aspect of our modern industrial society that we don't want to talk about this. And I'll tell you in a minute why we don't want to talk about this. It's because we believe in the infinite. And does this curve look infinite to you? No. It goes up and then it comes down. And what was the other curve which we wanted? That was infinite. So you want money to grow infinitely, but you don't want to accept that resources are finite. That is a simple reason why we have been conditioned not to think about this. We have been conditioned that this should not be a part of our curriculum or studies. But let's, now that I've told you about this, what does this mean? This means that if I drill for a resource, whether it be coal, I'm drilling for coal, or whether it be oil, or whether it be natural gas, when I drill one oil well, say the oil well has 100,000 barrels, okay, it's a reservoir. As I drill it, it gives me more oil, and faster. And when half the oil in that oil well is over, only half, it starts falling. Now, does your car behave like this? That when your petrol tank is half empty, does your car slow down? It doesn't slow down. Then how come this happens? The earth does not behave like a petrol tank. The water tank above your house, you're having a shower, and you use us half the water in it. Does it slow down? It doesn't. Why have we not thought about it? Because we think that the earth is a petrol tank. We think the earth is a water tank. We think the earth behaves like a petrol tank does, but it doesn't. It is completely different. The earth behaves like a body. Our bodies behave like this. The earth is a body. The earth is not a tank. Now that you can go down in much detail, but it's really, really important. So when you reach half the point, it's called the peak. And for a good reason, you can see it's a peak. But it's surprising, there's still half left, but you start going down. This is completely different looking from what I had just shown you, and that follows the laws of geology. Who makes the laws of geology? Whichever god you believe in. So the laws of geology are not made by man, whereas the laws of money are made by man. It's up to man how he makes up. He says, money is equal to value. Then money has time value. Then this time value must compound. This must happen forever. This was, I don't think, anything that God said. In fact, most religions did not believe in interest. Old Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, they used to, interest was haram for a very good reason. So I don't mean to sound religious. I'm not a religious person in that sense. But I just want to tell you that there was a damn good reason why we didn't believe in the infinite and we didn't believe in interest. Because this is finite. You notice this is a green curve. Because the green curve is the behavior of a body. So we go a little bit ahead. It follows the laws of geology. And just to let you know that I didn't make this up from my mind, I have to give you a little bit of history. And the history is that this gentleman, how many of you have heard of King Hubbard? How many of you have heard of Einstein? No, don't feel scared. Yes. So you've heard of Einstein, who talks about something E is equal to mc squared, which I don't even know whether it really matters. But we haven't heard of Hubbard, who told us that oil wells behave like this. He was giving us the most real bit of information that if somebody in your house tells you your food is going to get over 3 days from now, would you find that more valuable than if somebody tells you Venus is going to be on this quarter of the sky? Which is more important? Who would you rather give a Nobel Prize to? We give it to those guys. We don't give it to the guys who tell you that your food is limited and there's so much food left and you better watch it. So this is our value system, you know? This is the way we think that what is more important. Poor King Hubbard, he was not an environmentalist. He was not an activist. He was not a Naxalite. He was not a Maoist. He was not a tree hugger. He was an oil engineer. That means he had no ulterior motive to say this. His objective, he used to work for an oil company. His job was to see that every time an oil well is drilled in America, America was the seat of oil in the earlier part of the 20th century and 19th century latter half, 1850 to 1970. So America had to know, US guys had to know what is happening. And he was working for Shell Oil. All of you have heard of Shell Oil. Shell is one of the biggest companies, correct? So his job was, and he was just doing his job, like anybody else who does a job. So one oil well is drilled, he checks out, and just when that oil well reaches the peak, it slows down. So he says, oh God, there must be something wrong with this well. Let's go and drill another well. Let's check out that well. It did the same thing. Next one, next one, next one, next one, all over Texas, all over America. When, no matter how many wells he looked at, each well behaved in a bell curve. What does it mean? It means that when half the well is oil is over in the well, it slows down. So what do you need to do if you were running Shell Oil? Let me ask the management guys a question. What do you do if one oil well starts going down? You drill another one. And what happens when that same thing happens there? You drill another one. So in order to keep this going like this, you need to keep drilling more and more wells. Now, how many wells can you drill? There's some limit to it, right? And that's what he found, was that if you looked at a region, say like if you looked at the whole of Texas, he found that all these little wells here, their behavior added up to a big bell curve. This is mathematics. All little bell curves add up. If you add all of it up, you know, this plus this plus this plus this, this will be, you know, if you added up all the wells here, the total will be another bell curve, which means that Texas, if that is the output of Texas, Texas will reach its peak also in the middle. When only half the oil of Texas is over, it'll start slowing down. So what will you do? You'll go to some other state, Nebraska, Florida, God knows where, Colorado. And what happens when all the states are done? You'll have to move somewhere else. So he discovered that he was able to predict, because of his science, that when US discovery, see, before you drill oil, you have to discover it. I can't drill oil unless I know there's oil here, right? So I know there's oil here, there. So I add that all up, and these are my discoveries. This is my discovery curve. I've discovered it, but I haven't produced it yet. I start producing it here, because it takes some time to put up the production factory and everything. So there is a lag time between discovery and production of 40 years. This is a known fact in those days. Now it's become less. But when the discoveries peak, that means he found that you're not finding more oil in America and your discoveries are dropping. He knew that in America, 40 years later, your production would drop. So in 54, he predicted, in 1930, his data was showing 1930, but it took him a while to collect that data, you know, because you have to go down the curve and then you realize, oh yes, indeed we're going down. So somewhere in 54, he predicted that US oil will peak in 1970. That means US, in its geographical boundaries, cannot get any more oil than this in a day, in a month, in a year. That's the maximum rate of extraction. That is scary news, okay? So nobody believed him. They said, this guy is nuts. He was a good scientist, but he's just gone mad. So he had to wait from 54, 16 years, and when 1970 came, he was proved right. This is what it looked like. These dots are the total production of US oil wells. And he predicted in 54 that this was going to happen in 70. He is one of the most amazing empirical scientists. An empirical scientist is one who deals with numbers, measurement. Okay, Einstein was a theoretical scientist. He was a mathematical scientist. But this is an amazingly difficult job. And he proved it, and he was right. America reached its peak. And when it reached its peak, do you think America can make more products? It cannot. It cannot increase its number of products, but you have to increase. So what did they do? They went into the Middle East. So that's how the Middle East started. US peak happened in 1970. And similarly, he proved that global peak, because obviously, as I just told you, you went from one state to the other, now your country is done with, you've gone to another country. How many countries do you have that have oil like the Middle East? Very few. So he found that when global discoveries had peaked in 1960, he predicted again that 40 years later, the world would peak in 2000. So everybody was waiting for it. We were waiting for it, and I'll come to that part of the story. But why am I talking about oil? Most people say oil is not the only source of energy. We can just go to something else. We can go to wind, we can go to nuclear, we can go to solar panels, we can go to fuel cells, we can go to, you know, all kinds of funny answers people have. But let me tell you what oil is. It just requires a little bit of understanding. There's one more thing that educational institutes do not satisfactorily prepare people for, of what oil means in our industrial world. Oil doesn't just run our world. This is one of the things that oil does. It's only one thing, one aspect of oil, that it runs your world. Okay, what do you mean by running it? It means moving your ships, moving your planes, moving your trains, moving your trucks, the actual movement of things. Normally when we think of oil, we think of movement. We think, then we'll get a car which runs on solar, as if that's the only thing that oil does. It's not the only thing it does. It runs your industry. It does your agriculture. Every aspect of your food is done with machines. You actually put in 10 calories of petrol into 1 calorie of food that you eat in an industrial country. The more industrial the country is, the more is the ratio of oil in their food. Not literally oil, but the component of oil energy. That means if you're eating an apple, and the apple gives you 10 calories, 100 calories have gone in to grow that apple and bring it to you. Now what do you think you're eating? You're not eating sunlight. Food was meant to be sunlight. Sunlight becomes food. You're eating stored sunlight. You're eating oil. Oil is stored sunlight. There's a huge difference, but we're never told about that. Electricity. Coal is a fossil fuel. Most of it is generated with coal. So it doesn't only run your world, it does something even more drastic. 1 barrel of oil, which is 42 gallons, only 78% goes to run your world. Only 78% gives you petrol, which runs all these things. The remaining 22% of the barrel builds your world. The actual fabric, the seats you're sitting on, the nylons, the plastics, bitumen for your roads. Where do you get bitumen from? It's a byproduct of petroleum. You do not get it from anything else. Plastics, 30% of all your electronics is plastics, your packaging. God knows how many things. That's again a byproduct of petroleum. You don't just get it from anywhere else. And solar panels are built with all this, incidentally. And people say that's an alternative. I don't see how. Fertilizers. It's again a byproduct of fossil fuels. Lubricants. What you put in so that your gears work smoothly. And apart from that, all these things. Insulators, pharmaceuticals. So many things go into actually building your world that is a component of oil. 42 of 6,000, I can just give you so many of these, you know. So if you were in one of these industries, you are immensely dependent on oil, you don't even know it. And the third thing that oil does is that it's non-renewable. The third limiting factor is that it's non-renewable. Now we know the word non-renewable, but to what degree? To what extent is it non-renewable? Here's the sun, and here is oil. And it is called ancient sunlight for a very good reason. It's the sunlight which has become oil, because that's why we call it fossil fuels. They become plants, animals, which get crushed. It took about 250 million years of the sun falling on the earth, becoming all these things, dinosaurs, all the things that you see in there, all the living things, organisms, marshes, trees, forests. It took 250 million years of that to collect and become 2 trillion barrels of oil. And half of it, we finished it in 150 years. So how many of you are accounting students here? Now, can you please do this balance sheet for me and tell me if this company is profitable? This company is dead. This company is bankrupt. This company, you don't even bother to bail it out. And this company is our modern industrial world. Just do the ratio. If you have a capital savings account that has got 10 lakh crores in it, and you finish it off in 10 years, how sustainable are you? So this is the level that we're talking about. So oil does these three things. Blood of the industrial world runs it, builds it, irreplaceable. So what happens when it peaks? I come back to my argument. Here's money, there's oil. This is from the mind or the financial system, that is the body of the earth. The body has to actually make this happen. This doesn't happen on its own. This grows when energy grows. I already showed that to you. Now we put the two graphs together and we see how does money behave. This is how money has behaved since 1900. We've actually managed to make our money grow. These are real figures. We've actually managed to make our money grow in an exponential curve. And we are very happy. We say, wow, look at us. This is what we've done. We'll see in a minute how real this is. And here is how oil behaves. This is the productivity of oil. Can you see a similarity between these two curves and what I had shown you, between the coach and the runner? The coach had a similar concept, and the runner's body behaved similarly. Only thing now, we're talking about the real concept, and that's a real body. Do they look alike to you? Do you think that can make this happen? No? Yes? They're completely different. One goes up for a while, and then goes down, and the other one keeps going up. So when you put them together, it's fine when it's going like this, because when you need more products, when Dharmesh wanted to increase his productivity, he needs more cake, more sugar, more. The earth is able to give you more oil. So in this phase, the mind and the body are in sync. Whatever the mind of the financial system demanded, the body of the earth was able to give. So we call it paradise times. You remember the three times I told you about in the beginning? Paradise times, and then something else, and something else. Well, this is phase one. Because whatever we were asking for, the oil production goes in the same way, and you're able to do it. So we were very happy. We said, this is going to go on forever. But in the second phase, so we use this. We use these four rules. You remember that? The money onion. We use these rules to make money grow like this. And that's growth happening here, and this is happening here. Now what happened in the second phase? Somewhere in the late 60s, the global oil production, as per our measurements, okay, we found this, really, in fact, that oil slows down. See, you can distinctly see that it's going slower. It's not going like this. Here it was, and here it's not. So there was a differential building up between how much oil was needed to run your industrial world for money to grow this way. So we said, I'll tell you what, money still has to grow this way. Let's make some more new rules. Let's add some new concepts. So we institutionalized the concept of the stock market. Now, what is the stock market? The stock market is institutionalized borrowing. Because now, Dharmesh's company has reached the point where he needs 100 crores. He can't go around borrowing 10 lakhs from different people. He needs some place where he can borrow 100 crores at one shot. And that's what the stock market allows you to do. But what does a stock mean? Why do I buy that share in Dharmesh's company? I buy it. Because, not because he's making this many more products, that's your dividend. If you guys are aware that dividends are different from stock price, right? Which one is real? And which one is imaginary? The dividend is the only thing that is real. So when Tata makes 10% more trucks, that money, it shares with you and they call it the dividend. But I wouldn't have bought it if he told me that my dividend is only going to be this much. He told me that if you buy my stock and we trade it, on Dalal Street, then it will be this much. Now what do you call that? I call it gambling. So what we in fact did was we started an institutionalized gambling den. And we approved it with the stamp of the government saying this is fine. But if you gamble from your house, we'll arrest you. So we needed to do that. Again, I'm not saying it's a moral thing. We needed to do it because the only way you could make money appear to grow is only if you were betting on it. The betting part was making it grow. If you're getting what I'm saying. Okay, so this is the share price, and this is the dividend. This is the dividend, this is the share price. This is the dividend, this is the share price. So the share price is a perceived value, which is only filling in the gap between your concept and your reality. But this game is going on for a while, and very soon, we ran into another problem. We ran into a liquidity problem, which means the banks, they had to earn more interest. Because now you're reaching a steep part of the curve, okay? This curve goes up faster and faster. So what do the banks need to do? Banks used to lend 10% and hold 90%. But then that 10% was not enough to pay back the interest to everybody. So they said, let's lend 20% and hold 80%. Then they said, no, even this is not enough because this curve is going up faster. Let's lend 30% and hold 70%. Then they lend 50% and held 50%. The more you are lending and the less you were holding gives you more interest for sure. But what else happens? It's very risky. Because if I've lent out 80% of all the deposits and I'm only holding 20%, and all you guys come and you want your money back, do I have it? And how do I know that the guys I lent it to will be able to return it to me? So what was increasing on the right side was something else. It was called risk. So while you were making growth go up this way, by mental and imaginary means, your risk was increasing on the right side. And then again we reached a ceiling, because you can only have so much money. Remember, we said money has to grow. So we are trying to find newer and newer rules to keep money growing. Whether it be by stocks, whether it be by fractional reserve banking, whether it be by no gold standard, and that is the absolute sacrilege. Because money was supposed to be a measure of how much gold there is. And gold was, and you were only supposed to print as much money as there is gold, because you can't cheat with gold. It's a very difficult metal and it stays forever. But we suddenly changed our mind and we said, no, let's remove this ceiling. US did it in 1970, Nixon did it in fact. But I don't blame him, because you can only print as much gold as you have. But if money has to grow, you cannot attach it to the gold standard. You say, forget the gold standard, we will print as much as we want. So that makes the currency completely fiat. That means it's not backed by any real value. That means you're becoming more and more risky, which is on the right. And so on and so forth. Finally reached a part of the curve, whichever business I'm talking about. In this case, I'm talking about Dharmesh's cake business. Now he needed 1,000 crores. He wanted to pick up 1,000 crores to make his company expand. And he has only 50 crores to put down as a deposit to the bank. The bank is willing to give him 1,000 crores with him putting 50%, and that is called leveraging. So these are the kind of new concepts that we included into our financial and economic laws, because the simple fact was that he had to keep growing, he had to keep borrowing more money. What he started with was 10 lakhs, then he borrowed 50 lakhs, then he borrowed 1 crore, then he borrowed 5 crores, then 20 crores. Now he needs to borrow 1,000 crores if his company has to grow. But he puts down, he borrows the 1,000 crores, putting a deposit of 50 crores. But that's very risky. If he doesn't return the money, that's going to be crazy. So the bank says, what do we do? So we came up with the next concept called options. So options is a way of reducing your risk. In other words, Dharmesh doesn't have to worry. He doesn't have to return 1,000 crores if his business fails. He can return 100 crores on top of it and get away. So he borrowed 50 crores. He gives 100 crores more. But how do you price it? How do you know how much you should pay? Should it be 100 crores? Should it be 80 crores? Should it be 120 crores? I hope you guys are following what I'm saying. That is that the money curve keeps going exponentially up and you have to keep chasing it. And to make it appear as if this is true, you're making more and more rules. You're making more and more rules from your mind, which are more and more imaginary and more perceptual. But that does not mean that real growth is happening like this. Real growth is happening like this. There's a huge difference between this and that. And how do we price an option, like I said? So we came up with this. This is called the Black and Scholes options pricing formula. It is a very, very simple formula. I'm sure all of you can understand it. Now don't look so confused. You're not supposed to understand this. Even Warren Buffett doesn't understand this. But this is the level of madness that we went into because we were chasing money growth. We said, this is the level of mathematics that you need to understand options. And we added the next concept to it called Black and Scholes. These two guys came up with that formula, and they were given the Nobel Prize, and they were celebrated, and they were so happy that they used their own formula and lost $4.7 billion. It collapsed. I'm so glad that somebody's here is finding that humorous, but that's what it meant. That the very guys who you celebrated and you said, boss, you guys are too good, we give you the Nobel Prize, which I wouldn't take for anything, because they really were not interested in reality. They were only interested in complex mathematical equations. So if you want to get the Nobel Prize, just come up with a mind-blowing complex equation that nobody understands, and you'll get the Nobel Prize. And that's what they did, and they lost so much money, and everybody forgave them on top of it. He said, no problem, yeah, come on. Sabse galti hoti hai. So that's what happened with Black and Scholes. Now we had reached the hundreds of trillions. Now we had, remember, this curve is growing. If you were the CEO over here, you would have to make this happen. And if you were a CEO over here, you would have to make that happen, okay? So you are trying to chase the important. Have you heard this phrase called QSQT? No, not my movie. But there's another phrase that is floating around called quarter se quarter tak. Have you all heard of that? Well, that is the predicament that you fall under. You cannot do 10-year planning. Forget a 10-year plan, forget a 5-year plan, forget a 3-year plan, forget a 1-year plan. You have to think of each quarter because that's how steeply your curve is going. You cannot possibly imagine more than a quarter. Nobody has the brain ability to understand more than a quarter. That's where we have reached. So it's become QSQT. So that's exactly what is happening. The banks had to now show growth of hundreds of trillions of dollars. How do they do it? It's not even real growth. There was something in place called the Glass-Steagall Act. The Glass-Steagall Act, I know that you guys may be finding this a bit taxing and boring, but you must know about it. And when you go back and you read about it, it'll all make sense in a flash, why this was said. Because right now it looks like, okay, who the hell cares about the Glass-Steagall Act? Okay, don't worry about the Glass-Steagall Act. Just look at a simple aspect, that every time we were in trouble to make this go from here to here, we just added another concept. It doesn't matter what the concept is, don't even try to understand it. And every time we were in trouble to go from here to here, we added another concept. What does it take to add another concept? You just use it from your mind. So now we needed a lot of money, and the banks were not allowed, the commercial banks and investment banks. How many of you know that commercial and investment banks are two different things? Okay, commercial banks are the ones that have your money. Should they be playing around with your money? No, because when they did that in 1929, they blew it, and everybody lost their money, and everybody went bankrupt. So the American government decided that these two should not be one. You can't have your best friend who's also your investor, something like that. So you keep these two things separate. So the commercial banks, the investment banks were going nuts. They had no liquidity to play with. They're saying, hey, look at all that depositors, wonderful money lying there. Look at all those assets, we can't even play with it. And they put the pressure on the US government for 60 years to remove that act, which did not allow them to do that. Why did they put pressure on it? Because they had to make money grow. They needed more liquidity. They needed more tokens. Okay? And the moment that act was removed, what they could do was to combine this with this and this to do that. Because now you were dealing with hundreds of trillions of dollars. You could design complex financial instruments. You could design derivatives. Hedge funds, CDOs, SIVs, slice and dice, housing mortgages, and repackage it on paper to show you fantastic growth. But you needed to remove this, and you needed this, and you needed this, and you needed this. So this was a combination of four or five concepts to come up with a lethal concept that makes your growth. And people were going nuts. And we were sitting on the side and watching. Poor fools like us who only understand energy and resources. We were trying to warn the world. You can go back and read in the forums. We said, this is insane. This is going to collapse. This is completely toxic. It doesn't make sense. And let me tell you one more thing. This is not only in 2007, 2008. We are saying it now. It's going to happen in 2014, end of 15, sometime. There's a huge bubble of the similar order which is being blown up. So all these guys were very, very happy. Mind-blowing growth happening here, crazy risk happening there. This is what it looks like when you put it all together. In one picture, you can understand what the hell is happening. If you have a concept that looks like this, impossible, vertical, and to fulfill this concept, you have a reality that looks like this, because this is what makes this possible, then it's fine when you're going from here to here. But the moment it parts, you need newer and newer concepts, and notice the gap is increasing. At each stage, you need a more powerful concept to make this growth possible. So that's called the money onion. It gives you crazy, unbelievable growth, but crazy risk for this to happen. We were waiting to reach the peak, which was predicted by Hubbard. It was no surprise to us. It was a surprise to all those Harvard kids who were getting millions of dollars. It was a surprise to all the Princeton kids who got millions of dollars. It was a surprise to all the banks who thought they were in trillions of dollars. We were not surprised. Remember the coach and the runner? And the runner's body reaches its peak and the concept collapses. We were waiting for this. And March 2008, there was a huge explosion. And we were not surprised. We were waiting 50 trillion. We had reached peak oil. Oil is the blood of your industrial society. If it stops growing up, your industrial concept of growth just shatters. It explodes, it implodes. It doesn't have to end. It has to just stop growing. The concept that most people think is, oh God, we have so much oil, we don't need to reach the end of oil. It's not the end of oil that is important. There's a lot of oil here. There's 1 trillion barrels. That doesn't matter. What matters is it's not going up. And $50 trillion got wiped out in 6 months. Trillion is a huge amount. $1 trillion is a huge amount. $1 trillion is $1,000 billion. $1 billion is 1,000 million. Three phases, true, false, fails. My lecture is rather boring, I guess. No problem, no. It's for those who wait. So in 1850, this is the concept that started. The concept of growth, the religion which we believe in, that something should grow forever, started in 1850 because of oil. And now, after peak, we are into a totally different era. The concept of growth has evaporated. We are into descent. We are into shrinkage. What you're watching, if you read the newspapers, and you'll see people saying, you know what, this is all because of Congress. Oh, this is because Chidambaram is, you know, Mr. Chidambaram doesn't know what the hell he's doing. Oh, that is, hold on a second here. There's no Mr. Chidambaram in Europe. There isn't one in America. There isn't one in Japan. There isn't one in China. Why is it happening everywhere? It's definitely not got anything to do with the peculiarities of India. Everywhere growth is down. They call it austerity in Europe. Austerity is a wrong word. Austerity sounds like a moral choice. Austere, please don't use it, you know. You're refraining yourself from using something while it's there. I'm telling you it's not there. It is shrinkage. Now in economics, what is the first principle that you're taught in economics? What is the bedrock belief of economics, modern economics? Sorry? Huh? Scarcity. I would say it is growth. I would say it's the concept of growth is the fundamental bedrock of economics, time value of money. I mean, do you honestly teach in economics that 10 lakhs should remain 10 lakhs? Everything that you do is to make money grow. So the core principle of economics is growth, and we are in an inversion, we are in shrinkage. Here's another simple thing to look at. Everything on this planet is in exponential growth. Species extinction, exponential. Loss of tropical rainforest, exponential. Fisheries exploited, exponential. These are all life signs of the planet, okay? It's not a very healthy sign. Do you think water usage should be going exponential? Do you think fisheries should be exploited exponentially? Just look at it. You're exploiting this much and suddenly you go like this. That's what we're going to, it's going to come to. It's going to come to scarcity. So scarcity is the result of it. Scarcity is not the premise of it. If the premise of economics is scarcity, then it's a horrible science. It's creating scarcity. The premise of economics is growth. The fundamental premise of classical economics is money has to grow. You do everything to the time value of money, the 7% interest, and that it should compound. That is the premise of economics. Scarcity is what economics causes. So it's exactly the opposite from what you say. CO2 concentration, exponential. Ozone depletion, exponential. Number of cars, exponential. What does number of cars exponential means? Pollution is exponential. Usage of resources is exponential. Usage of petroleum is exponential. Paper consumption, exponential. That means the number of trees you cut is exponential. But all these are life signs. All these mean that you're killing the planet. But why did we decide to do all this? Because we decided something else before that. And what is that? That the GDP of the world should grow exponentially up. And that is the red curve here. This was our plan. We planned it. We have universities for it. We have courses for it. We planned it. So why are you surprised that this is happening? Why should we even bother to have an ecology department? When you're saying, no, our intention is that the GDP of the world should grow up exponentially. It's like saying, I'm going to drink exponentially. What do you think will happen to my heartbeat? My blood sugar level, my cholesterol level, it will go up exponentially. If I say I'm going to smoke exponentially, what do you think is going to happen? All my life signs will go up exponentially. So if I do a silly thing, like drinking exponentially, obviously I'll cause these diseases in my body. And that's what we did. We consciously decided that we have to make money grow exponentially. And whatever it takes to make that money grow, we take from the body of the earth and make it grow exponentially. And that's what we did. This is the disease that we are in. Take natural capital, burn it. That is all inanimate stuff. Ecological capital, rivers, trees, clean air, soil, fertility, trees, plants, burn it. Social capital, the free time that people have, relationships, you know, families spend time together. No, now they're working day and night, even Saturdays, even Sundays. That is social capital. These are all qualitative capital. These are, in fact, the health capital of your planet and your... This is not a quantitative capital. That is the quantitative capital coming out that side. Cultural capital. All the things that were free for everybody to use. Ideas, songs, tunes, folklore, genes. Now we're copywriting it. This gene belongs to Monsanto. Monsanto didn't make that gene. This squiggle belongs to Apple. How can one squiggle belong to Apple just because they made it their logo? So we take cultural capital. Spiritual capital, honesty, integrity, faith, trust, values. So we burn all these five. What do I mean by this? Like a simple thing like making an ad film where you show Akshay Kumar jumping off a plane and grabbing a thumbs up halfway down and landing on a beautiful girl's lap who happened to be at the right place at the right time and drinking it and doing this and taking away 10 crores. Or a girl pulling a Jeep with her hair. It's advertising, it's not telling lies. What's lies about it, yeah? So that is what we believe. We believe you can, it's perfectly okay to tell lies, to sell a product, to make money grow. It's perfectly okay, now we call it HR department. We call it management. Make people work and be happy at a low salary. So we have a lot of lovely words for these things, but that's loss of spiritual capital. That's why you're finding so many scams happening. And we say, oh my God, I tell you, these guys are so corrupt. Of course they will, poor chaps will be corrupt. I don't blame them at all. We are all corrupt in various ways because we have to burn every kind of capital to make this damn engine go, to make this thing come out. And when it comes out, what does it say? It says, I want to grow. So it comes back and burn, comes out, more of it. And what does that say? I need to grow, come back, burn more. And what does that say? Please keep doing this ad infinitum because we said perpetual, exponential, quantitative growth is our religion. We based our premise of everything that we do based on time value of money, exponential time value of money. Every time you do a business study, a financial study, you can't tell your, would you tell your business, you know, whoever you're doing it for, look, you have 10 crores, be happy. So 10 crores. No, 10 crores has to become 11 crores, has to become 13, 16, 32. And to do that, what do you need? You need this, don't be surprised. But my point is not whether you should do this or not. My point is how long can you do this? You remember the beginning of my argument? It is not the morality of it, it is the possibility of it. I'm not trying to give you guys a bhashan. I'm not saying don't do this. Please don't misunderstand me. I'm saying, will you be able to do this? This is my challenge to anybody who's in the financial world today, who's claiming to get growth back. Our challenge, the people who study bell curves, the reality curve, the body curve, and the mind curve, it is mathematically impossible to make this curve do this curve. You don't even need a 7-year-old kid to tell you that. You ask him, ke aise agar ek cheez jaye aur aapko ye chahiye to ho sakta hai, bolega nahi ho sakta. So it's better he doesn't go to school. Because when you go to school, you're taught how to fudge and make the money on it. You're taught how to fudge and create the concept of shares as real value. You're taught that leveraging is perfectly fine and there's no risk involved. You're taught that Black and Scholes should be given the Nobel Prize and you should also try to do that. But that is the crazy, crazy delusion that we are in. Health capital burnt to make money. The disease is growth for the sake of growth. The ideology of a cancer cell. Just think about it for a second. What does your cancer cell, what do you mean by cancer? When you have one liver cell and it goes 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, you call it cancer. And you try to find a cure for it. You spend 500 crores, you start Hinduja Hospital. But when the same thing happens in our financial system, we call it progress. This is how crazy and absolutely lunatic we are. Absolutely insane. This was said by Edward Paul Abbey. I'm trying to put things, it's a pity that some gentlemen and ladies left. But this is the crux of my it rounds up and finally starts making sense. But I have to go through a slightly boring path because I have to give you that information, which no part of our education system does. But in a nutshell, we are the cancer cells. The ideology of modern economics is the ideology of a cancer cell. And we are seeing the cancer. You're seeing your forests going, you're seeing your species going, you're seeing that the groundwater is depleting, you're seeing chemicals in your soils, you're seeing global warming happening, you're finding the number of diseases increasing. That is global cancer. It is not an ecological crisis. We've nicely dubbed it ecological crisis. Oh, it's something to do with these plants, it's got nothing to do with us. No, it is the cancer of the earth. Another lovely statement by him, anyone who believes that exponential growth can go on forever, this is about possibility, is either a madman or an economist. It's as simple as that. How can you imagine exponential growth? Please try doing 2 to the power 1, 2 to the power 2, 2 to the power 10, 2 to the power 20. 2 to the power 11 minus 2 to the power 10 is 1024. You can still deal with it. Try 21 and 20. Try 31 and 30. Forget 31 and 30, try 24 and 25. It goes very fast. Exponential growth is a disease. To incorporate it into your systems is a form of a disease. It should be prevented, in fact. There should be a law to prevent economic growth. So what is the third curve? The third curve looks like this. The first curve was that red curve, which went up like that. First curve we pulled out of our head. You remember? We said money. And we designed the first curve. We said money is value, money has time value, money should compound, this should happen forever, and la 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 karke you made the first curve from your mind. And to make the first curve real, you took resources from the earth in a bell curve. That was the second curve. The earth should not behave that way because it goes into collapse mode. So the first two curves are undesirable. What is desirable? Desirable is something that can happen forever, ideally. And this is the amount of energy that we get from the sun. This is our budget. So if this is your budget, you have to live within that budget. This was the energy budget of the earth. The earth used to work perfectly okay within this budget. So much energy from the sun in summer, in winter it is less, in the day it's more, at night it's less. Next summer, next winter, day, night, next summer, next winter, closer to the earth. But it never goes here. Do you ever get this much energy from the sun on a particular day? No. Do you get so little? No, it goes between two bands. There is a definite pulse in which we get energy from the sun and it goes between two limits. Now go back. That was the dreaded word, limits. The reason why you were not shown the bell curve, you remember? And I asked you how many of you have learned this and why have your teachers not taught you? Because the bell curve has limits. We don't like limits. We hate limits. We believe limits should not exist. It is against our principle to believe in limits, more, whether it be IQ or whether it be achievement or speed, which is why our runners are taking steroids. You cannot push the body beyond that, but you're saying, no, I don't know if Usain Bolt does, but many of them are. And you're trying to stretch it by that 0.01 meters per second speed at any cost, but no matter what you do, will that runner be able to run at 100 kilometers per hour? No. So there are limits to the body. We don't believe in limits. The third curve goes within limits. This could be the third curve of your body. Your body works within limits. And what happens when you try to go out of that limit? You take steroids. If you want to operate here, if some of the runners want to, they take steroids. What does it do to their body? 2 years down the line, the cellular structure collapses. The tissues collapse. So that's what we did. This was our budget. This sunlight was collecting for 250 million years at this level. 1,000 a day, 1,000 a day, 1,000 a day, like your salary. For 250 million years, imagine that your forefathers have collected 1,000 a month, say, and it collects into, say, 10 lakh crores. That amount of energy was oil, and we found it in 1850. And we went burning up the curve. It had nothing to do with our mind. It had to do with the energy. When you have the energy available, you come up with mind-blowing schemes. You say, hey, let's make London town here. Let's make some bridges. Let's have some trains. Let's melt that iron. Let's dig for it 300 feet below the ground. How do you do it? So this was the crazy amount of energy which we burnt and went up there. And when we finished burning half of it, we're at the peak. We have only two ways to come down. One, come down is a must because we're up there. One is in denial. This is denial. Right now, the whole world is in denial. The whole world has been taught that infinite is our birthright. Infinity is our birthright. Anybody who talks less than infinity is a fool. But we have stopped. The last 5 years, just read the newspapers. We have stopped because we have reached peak. This is a geological fact. There's enough data. We were talking about it. We are not surprised. It is not a plot. It is not a moral decision. It is a reality. And we are trying to extend our moment there by doing all kinds of stupid things, like cutting our boreal forests in Canada, digging 5 miles below the sea. Amazingly crazy things. Because it's energy that makes money grow, not money that makes energy grow. It's energy that runs everything. Extend, crash. Extend, crash. The runner says, I want to run faster, takes more steroids, his body crashes. This is called the crash model. This has happened in civilizations all over the world. Angkor Wat, Mayan civilization, Mohenjo-daro. You overuse the resources of your neighborhood and increase your consumption, crash. Again, try to sustain it, crash. That's how these civilizations crashed. Now we are doing it at a grand scale. We are doing it at a global scale. And we imagine that something different is going to happen this time. Why would it be any different than what happened to all these civilizations? So we are in denial. Whenever you hear a minister saying, I'm going to get you growth back, what he means is I'm going to make you crash. So if you want to crash, please vote for him. What is the other way to come down? Because you know you have to come down. You know you're flying a plane and 3 engines have burnt out and only 1 engine is left. And the only sensible thing to do is to come down slowly. It's called controlled descent. And that's called transition. That means you have to live within the energy budget that the bell curve gives you. This is a bell curve. You cannot cheat the bell curve. You cannot change the bell curve. You cannot go against the bell curve. No matter how much you want your idea to be an exponential curve, reality is a bell curve. This is the statement that should be taught to all students who go into any kind of education. Reality is a bell curve. Live within reality. And so to do transition, chapter 5 of my book, there is an answer, but the answer is not simple. The answer is not, just do this. Just put a few windmills. Just put some 10,000 solar panels. There are no answers like that. Those are false answers. The real answer is that we'll have to go into transition, descent, we have to redesign a completely different world. That is the real answer. And that is what we have to accept. If we don't accept it, we will not go that way. We will come up with false solutions. And these are all false solutions where people are saying, oh, don't worry, we just have to put, it's all a question of putting solar panels. Chapter 3 will tell you why it's not. It'll tell you it's not a question of just putting 5,000 windmills or 50,000 windmills or 5 lakh windmills. There are only so many places where you can put windmills. It's got nothing to do with that. What now? We're in energy descent. This is our new reality. Energy descent is our new reality. Energy descent means shrinkage. Shrinkage means end of growth. That's it. Deal with this reality, or reality will deal with you. Thank you.
Sir, I would like to thank you for the talk to us the reality, what real thing is. But I think the problem of money rise is lies with the problem of inflation. What I think a problem with that. So to deal with that rate of inflation, we are going up and up so that we can earn that about of that level of money in real sense. So there is inflation. So we have to print more money to deal with that. So inflation has become the cause and effect of that price rise. Not price rise, that money rise.
And you think energy has nothing to do with it?
No. Energy has its own sense. But that rise of price, since we are facing the problem of inflation, so in that sense, we have to deal with a bit of money. So we are keeping growing and going up and up.
I want to ask you, between a horse and a cart, does the horse pull the cart or does the cart push the horse?
Horse pulls the
cart. Right. Inflation is a result of growth and creating this. Whenever you overuse your resources, through the resource gets expensive. We are using everything to grow and we are using things unnecessarily. I have never understood, there is no inflation so one second. One is the problem is that you cannot chase inflation by doing the same thing because you'll only cause more inflation. Okay, one thing. Second thing is that you're not bringing in the role of energy in all this. My point now is not whether you should chase inflation or not. My point is, what happens when energy declines? Will you be able to do it?
No, sir, the cause of inflation is also that we are not matching up the production level. So that gap is...
And how do you do production?
No, I am in for of you. But I'm telling that inflation is something to doing with that money. Right?
Okay, I want you to become the finance minister and I want you to fight inflation. And according to you, inflation can be dealt with more production, correct?
Yes.
And more efficient production, right?
Yes.
And what does that require?
Resources.
Energy, fundamentally. Because all other resources you pull out with energy. How do you pull out the copper from the ground? How do you melt it? How do you shape it? How do you transport it? So every resource is fundamentally dependent on your key resource called energy. Every other resource is useful, but it doesn't become useful unless you have energy to bring it into action. You can have all the iron under the ground. In fact, you can have a lot of oil, but if the oil is so far down that it takes you one barrel of oil to pull out one barrel of oil, would it be economically feasible to do it? That ratio is called EROEI equal 1:1. So it is not how much resource there is, it is whether you have cheap oil to make it happen. Fundamentally, in all of economics, we completely ignore the fact, the role of energy. I contest all of economics. The real science is energetics. This is what I'm trying to say. Even in your answer, in your question, you never brought in energy. You are almost assuming that energy is there for us to take. So you're saying, my problem is inflation. How do I solve inflation? Which is all what all the finance ministers are saying and all. To solve inflation, we need to increase productivity, increase efficiency, et cetera, whatever their paradigms are. But never do they stop to ask, but is the energy available at the right price? They never ask that question. I've never seen it in any economic times, any business standard, any business or financial paper. You know what they say? Money is the capital at the top of the triangle. Energy and art is down here. If you have enough money, you can get energy, If you throw 1,000 crores at an oil well, the oil well doesn't start giving you oil if it doesn't have any in it. So the illusion that economists sadly have is that the defining capital is financial capital. The defining capital is energy. Energy is the top of the triangle. If you don't have that energy, your desire may be completely valid that we should reduce inflation. I grant you that. But in order to be able to do it, you need energy, and you don't create energy. And I just explained to you that energy behaves in a bell curve, and now we are in descent of energy. When a resource descends, what happens to the price of the resource? It goes up. Today, our economies worldwide are wobbling because oil is $100 plus. We had designed our global economic system to run at $20, $30 a barrel. The moment oil goes up to $80 plus or $100 plus, those same models fail. Your concept, your company, let's say you're running Maruti. For Maruti has taken a loan from the bank of 1,000 crores and they have to return it with interest. What does Maruti have to do? It has to make more cars. How are you going to make more cars when you have less energy? So I'm trying to take you back to grassroots fundamental starting point is energy. Your argument is completely valid only in the economic argument level, and that's why I'm trying to tell you that economics is a false science. It only deals with the laws of money. Equity, debt, subsidy, liquidity, interest rate. You're talking symbolic talk. You're never talking real stuff. You're never telling me that what's happening to the energy? Are we in ascent or descent? How much energy? Which kind of energy? I can give you a lot of electricity, but your car doesn't run on electricity. I can give you a lot of kerosene to drink, but that doesn't mean that you can drink kerosene. It has a lot of energy. So it has to also be the right kind of energy. So energy laws are very different from financial laws. And sadly, the financial world is going to just discover, and they're in denial, that actually it is energy that runs your modern industrial world and not financial capital. Financial capital you can keep, We've been printing. Look at America's got $17 trillion of printed of debt. $17 trillion America has borrowed from the future. Can you tell me how America is going to return that? $17 trillion. And you know what they're doing? Every time they reach the debt ceiling, they just print more money and increase the debt ceiling once more. And when they reach into trouble, that's what all the countries are doing. Japan is doing it, UK is doing it, America is doing it, India is going to start doing it shortly. India was not such an industrialized country. We were not as crazy. We used to think that we are not as advanced as America. But look at the condition of those countries today. So it doesn't matter how much money you have. It matters how much energy and resources you have. And that is finite. And you cannot fudge it. You can't say we'll replace oil with something else. This is a classic fallacy of economics, that you can always replace one resource with the other. You cannot. If you don't have enough iron ore, can you make your bridges with gold? Can you make it with zinc? Can you make it with copper? Can you make it with aluminum? You can't, because iron is a cheaper metal. To make bridges on that scale, you cannot use another element. Energy is the core. Try and understand it from an energy point to use. Right now, we are in the process of starting forums to make economists and financial people aware of the laws of energy called energetics. Just like you have economics as a discipline, and economics has its own laws, time value of money, inflation, debt, whatever, you know, depreciation, whatever, you have a lot of, but those we have made up. The laws of energy we don't make. They are fixed, they are geologically fixed, they are thermodynamically fixed. And what we ran on is not energy that you can just collect from the side of your street. It is energy which collected over 250 million years, which you cannot repeat. So that is the problem, that is the predicament that we are in. We are not seeing the real cause of the issue, and we are thinking it's due to something else.
First of all, I have to compliment you for an exceedingly lucid and interesting lecture. The silence that you were perceiving was not the result of boredom. I'm sure everybody was stunned. And it was everybody was stunned into silence.
Okay.
But there was a underlying wit which we enjoyed, many of us, and were suitably amused at quite a few of your expressions. So thank you for this extremely nice treat. As I have mentioned to you in a recent communication, I don't speak as well as you do, and I'm not a patch of engaging speaker that you are. But whenever occasion comes, and whenever I say things of the kind you say, which I always try to butt in and say, because I have been also working on this for long, the reactions are, the first and foremost is, generally the audience feels I'm talking something very retrograde. See, India is into a high now, right now. You know, we are almost aping the West, which we used to fancy earlier. We always coveted the American style of living. We always coveted malls, McDonald's, all those statements of progress that we associated, classically the people associated with it. We are having it in India. We are having all kind of gadgets. We are having air conditioners. We are getting cars now, and so on and so forth. So we are on a high. And at that time, a guy comes around and says that you have to conserve. You start conserving. It sounds very true. The second thing is, as scientists, those who are trained in science, I'm not an economist, most of us are not economists, those who are trained in science, it should be very easy for them to understand and accept what you are saying. In fact, it is almost obvious, but it's surprising that not only economists, but a huge gathering of scientists all over the world are in the worst kind of denial than economists are. That is the most stunning aspect.
Yeah, I find that too.
For example, it doesn't take much deep knowledge of physics to tell that there can be nothing like zero pollution. Mm-hmm. There can never be an inexhaustible source of energy.
Exactly.
And so on and so forth. And but we are talking about it. We are talking about zero pollution concept. And then when I speak things like that, they say, no, technology is advancing. They say reuse, recycling. Mm-hmm. We can reuse everything, we can find, we can, whatever muck we create, we, they don't realize that there is residual energy and which is translates to residual pollution. I think one of the points that if you add, I'm sure you must have thought of it, whatever you said, apart from the limits to growth caused by the resources, the use of energy is forever creating more and more pollution, and which is adding to the burden of, it's not only consuming resources, it's also spoiling the balance resources. So it's a kind of a double jeopardy we are imposing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
So thank you for bringing out these points. See, let me tell you again that I'm not fundamentally, actually one correction, Mr. Abbasi, I'm not saying conserve. That is later, whether you conserve or you don't conserve. See, conservation will not help. You have to change your core paradigm. I'll give you an example. There's a billionaire, okay, Steve Jobs or somebody like him. Without saying Steve Jobs, but somebody who's a billionaire. And everybody's in awe that this billionaire, he's got hundreds of billions, but his own consumption is negligible. He sleeps in the dark, he sleeps on the ground, he's got only khadi, he rides a bicycle, he eats, drinks only carrot juice or whatever is there. He's amazing. He uses 1/1000th of what any of you or even the poorest man in India eats. And he's a billionaire, okay? And he gets onto his cycle every day and he cycles to work. And he doesn't take the lift, he walks up. And he walks up and goes into his non-AC'd cabin with no lights and no computers or whatever. And what does he do there? He turns his 10 billion into 20, 20 into 40, 40 into 80. So it is not what the billionaire does, it is what his billions do. So his conserving is of no value. So very many people fall into this trap, I'm conserving. It's not what I'm conserving, it's what my money is doing in the bank. It is the paradigm of money which I'm questioning, not individual. When you go into individual conserving, we go into a moralistic mode. Ki main to zyada nahi khata, main to choti gaadi use karta hu. You know, there are many communities in India, including the Gujaratis, who are very, very frugal. They make everything themselves. They're very, very frugal. Okay? But they're extreme businessmen. So it is what their business stuff does, not their... I'm not accusing any community, but I'm giving an example because we know it. That this is a fact. So frugality is of no measure. It is what you do in your business. It's your model of business, the model of economic growth, which is questionable. Even if you put off all the lights from New York Tokyo to San Francisco, for the next 6 months, it makes no difference because your industry is continuing to do the same thing, which is make money grow. And how do you make it grow? By burning. So it is that model which is being questioned, not conserving. Conserving comes at a second level. You change your model first and then conserve. But not changing your model and only conserving is a band-aid. It is an illusion. So many people say, oh, I'm using a hybrid car. Oh, fine if you're using a hybrid car, but what is your factory doing? What's your business model? My business model is growing at 7%. Well, too bad. I don't care whether you have a hybrid car or you don't have a car at all. So that is the problem. It takes a little while for people to understand the argument is not purely quantitative. It is a paradigm shift. It is not putting CFL bulbs. It's talking about your model of time value of money. The premise on which your financial economic systems are modeled on. Your banks will stop working the moment. These networks will stop working. The moment you say, oh, you mean to say there's no time value of money? How will a bank run? Too bad. But I'm not saying stop it. The earth is saying stop it. The earth is telling you, sorry, I can't give you more oil. So it is something, the second part, which I'd like to add, is not our insistence. I'm not insisting you do anything or anybody do anything. I'm telling you it's going to happen and it's happening. Even if you do not agree with me, it'll make no difference. Even if I don't do it, I'm not saying I'm morally right. I have money in the bank, I get 7% interest. So I'm not any holier than thou. But I'm saying it's not a question of moral choice anymore. It is the reality of energy descent which is emerging. Either you recognize it and flow with it. If you recognize it and you flow with it, you're more likely to be safe. You'll make the right financial choices. You won't just simply expand your business because in the first part of our industrial age, expansion was the given. It was the norm. If you made 100 cakes, everybody say, why 100? Yeah, your cake is damn good, make 200. That's what people told Dharmesh. Why 200? Yeah, make 400. The norm was to grow. And you could grow, because there were more money, more energy and resources. Now, the norm is not what you want to do. The norm is what the earth will allow you to do. So when you're in energy descent, you cannot look around you. Just go over the last 4 years, 5 years. See how many people have lost their jobs, how many factories are shut down, how much, and people are thinking this is, you mean to tell me suddenly all the political and all the smart people in every country have suddenly gone mad? They're suddenly incapable. Germany, France, Italy, Japan, have they all become incompetent suddenly? Have they all suddenly forgotten how to run industries? Have they all become, you know, inept at what they're doing? Obviously, there's something else which is common. And that is what we were talking about. So it is not a moral choice. It is not should we do it or should we not do it. We have to take the morality out of it, otherwise you won't understand the argument. Because up till now, most people mistake it to be a moral argument. I'm telling you, it's a physical, thermodynamic, geological reality. The physicists are telling you the biggest lies, not the economists. Because the poor economists were deluded to start off with. They thought money runs the world, but energy runs the world. So economists still believe it's all about financial capital. So they still talk loose talk like liquidity. How does it matter how liquid you are? When it happened in Germany, you could go, if you just imagine on this planet, there's one last loaf of bread left, and it's with you. And I come with $10 million, will you give it to me? So it has got nothing to do with liquidity. These rules of liquidity and all are assuming that the resources are there. They're assuming that if I have enough liquidity, enough tokens, I can buy it. I'm not ever taking depletion and bell curves into account. Bell curves have never featured in economists in their whole scheme of things. There is an assumption that if you have enough capital, you can just get it. So I'll give you 1,000 crores and I'll ask you to give me so many barrels of oil. Can you get it for me? You can't. So this is what we need to teach. We need to teach the discipline called energetics. Energetics is a completely different discipline. Energy is the real token of the universe. Your body works on energetics. If I give you 1,000 calories of food, can you do me 1,001 calories of work, please? Okay, I don't give you food for 3 months, and then I give you, 60 kilos of biryani. Will you agree to that? The concept of debt doesn't exist in energetics. In economics, debt is the first principle. So these laws of debt, time value of energy, there's no concept of time value of energy. Just because I keep 10 calories here, it doesn't become 20 calories with time. But with money, it does. So the laws of economics have been created with a hell of a lot of assumptions. And they are mathematical, mental constructs. The laws of energetics are eternal and universal. And we have been grossly ignoring energetics. Every river, every plant, every tree, every cloud follows energetics. No river which is at a height, you know about potential energy. It's at a height of say 5,000 feet. It has a certain amount of potential energy. It can only flow in a certain way. That is energetics. A river cannot just take off like this. A grassland, when there is sun in summer, with the energetic laws it increases. When it's winter, it shrinks. It follows energetics. It can never create the concept of deferred payment, which we can create in economics. So economics, sorry sirs, I mean, I don't mean to offend any of you, was always a bogus science. It was always a bogus science. The reason why we started believing it, it's like a very, very rich man, we believe he's a good guy because he's got a hell of a lot of money from his forefathers and he's doling it out. The day his money ends, he's not a good man. So economics was a false science.
But sir, I think the bigger culprits are scientists.
I agree with you.
Much, much bigger.
I totally agree with you. So I was coming to that, yeah.
Because not only economists, yeah, but the public at large has a perception that science has the solution to all.
Exactly, sir. That's why you said it, this is the first time somebody else has said this. I always say that I appear to be bashing economists. I was a physics student. I was very good at physics. I today blame the physicists much more. Because they're creating the illusion, guys, don't worry, we're working on something. this miraculous thing. Please give us 500 crores, 500,000 crores. That's all. So as long as you give us this, they're venture capitalists. Those guys are telling us lies. They want you to give, what happened to Suzlon? What happened to any of these, what happened in Germany? They took a lot of cheap, what is it called? Subsidized funds. It always has to be subsidized because it doesn't work on its own realm. It is energy deficient. So physicists are telling the biggest lies. They're misleading everybody and taking them down the garden path. They're saying, don't worry, there's fusion down the line. Fusion, for heaven's sake. It's not even an equation yet. It happens at 10 million degrees on the sun. Try to replicate 10 million degrees on the earth. How much energy does that take? So they're talking nonsense. And let me tell you one more thing. We have never created energy on this planet. Nuclear energy is not created energy. It is converted energy. You take a hell of a lot of fossil fuels in a very complex system without any accounting, with government subsidies, put it into this whole thing, and out comes electricity at an energy deficit and of a form that does not run your world. So it becomes electricity. So you're taking precious fossil fuels, which actually runs your world, and putting it through this crazy scheme and coming up with electricity. That's why it never worked. Everybody thought in the 60s when the first nuclear plant, this is energy too cheap to be metered. You don't need to meter this. And these guys you know why they didn't need to be metered? Because they never factored everything. You didn't even factor that after the life of the nuclear plant, how are you going to get rid of the radioactive material? What is it going to cost? Haven't you put that on your balance sheet? No, sir. We haven't put it. It's never going to happen. So it was always deferred. The lead iron, the lead lining that you need, the cold water that you need to pump, the uranium which you need to dig, the purification that you need to do, the storage that you need to do, the scientists which need to work, how do they come to work? When you add up the energy cost, that's called energetics. And energetics is a very difficult discipline because you don't know how to do it. So you never factor all the energy which is already there, which in a system. There is a system which you're using. And you're saying, I'm not using this system. That's what we did with the environment. The clean air and water you never put a price on it. You said, but that's God's. God has given it to us. Oh my God, that's crazy. So the same thing that they're doing in nuclear physics is they're never taking into account, ye road bani kaise? Ye bitumen kahan se aaya? Ye plastic jo aapne use ki, ye kahan se? You're never factoring all that. And the gross amount of energy to create a system within which you can create nuclear plants. But you need to make that system first and make that system run. So it is a very, very, very intriguing science. And sad to say that, and today I feel a little sorry for economists because they're living under this false hope that cousins, the physicists, are working on something mind-blowing for the last 80 years. And suddenly they're going to find the miracle answer. The patient is in ICU, and you're telling me that research is happening. So that's the kind of, everybody, every day they're expecting a miracle cure. Please ask me, I studied physics. How far are we from finding that miracle solution of giving you, and if you do find the solution, are you going to be able to make it grow exponentially? Your financial system only works exponentially. It doesn't work the moment so is your fusion going to work exponentially? Are you going to make nuclear plants exponentially? Are you going to put solar panels exponentially? Are you going to put windmills exponentially? How big is the planet? How many answers will you find? So it is much deeper than just that. Yes.
Sir, I have a few comments first regarding the economic model or the growth model. Classicals we had, they always predicted stagnation, that no matter how much you grow, at the end we are going to stagnate and there will be no growth. So, and at the peak of it, like today's lecture, we had Malthus who showed arithmetic mean, geometric mean, population will outgrow resources and we will not have food and then there will be K-minus bars, etc. So, but he was terribly wrong.
No, he was not wrong.
1 minute, sir.
I disagree.
And the second thing, polar bear and this thing are ecological, disasters like that. They were also, if you see in the first place how energy comes into being, it is because of those catastrophes.
Correct.
So despite our effort to stop it, it will not stop. Nature takes its own course, still. And sometimes it may be favorable. If, we have a desert farming in India, there will be somewhere in desert area like in Middle East or Sub-Saharan Africa, there will be, rain, it will change. The water levels will rise here, but so will the fish in that. So with that regard, and if rainfall declines here, somewhere it will increase. So it will go like that. Third, in economics, we don't bet on now resources. We bet on technology, endogenous growth theory. I finish my this thing. So in that, we just don't bet on resources. We know these are limited, and this is the definition of economics, that we have scarce resources and unlimited wanted. And you know, we try to manage that, and now we just bet on not on resources, but on technology in the latest.
And technology is not made with resources?
In the latest, this thing, or ideas, and those are never going to be ended. And finally, the assumption of this body, you know, Earth is like a body. There is a, you know, superstitious belief in that it is a some harmonious system, but it is not. You know, the only thing in India that we have left on nature, or that we have not intervened in, and that where we have not invested, is agriculture, irrigation. And you know, the monsoon is still dependent on that natural cycle, and that is the worst for farming and ever decline. And industry, we had a, you know, good growth compared to this agriculture. So this assumption that Earth is some harmonious system, and you know, now we better understand it, and we can simply freeze it to the conditions with the help of, you know, present knowledge we have, present instruments where we can freeze the living conditions, what we can do, you know, under which conditions human can live. And third, you know, the rent concept, that we have limited Earth. It is not infinite. So in economics, we have this rent concept where land as a whole is fixed resource, but to an individual, it is not fixed. Rent to an individual is cost. It is not to him for, you know, for the limitedness of it, but to it is, for an individual, it is a cost. Similarly, in the universe, Earth is, as if we take ourselves, universe as finite, yeah, it may be finite, but then for Earth, it is just cost. It doesn't help. It is not a rent. It is not a fixed resource. It has costs. We have to go there. We have to exploit. But it is not fixed in that sense for the individual, if we take in that sense Earth. So
if you can just tell me at the end of it, is there a problem or is there no problem?
No, actually, let me add a few things to what he has said. Actually, yeah. In economics, if we, increasingly depend on one particular commodity, say energy, okay, mm-hmm. without which we cannot grow, when its supply is being fixed, okay, and we increasingly exploiting it,
right.
When the day comes, then the price is going to be very high, and it becomes unviable to use such a resource. Obviously, it leads to invention of some substitutes. Okay, and this is happening now.
Right.
And I have data that the dependency of fossil fuel. Okay, the economy is growing. The world GDP is growing. Okay, every year we are producing additional output, but the dependency of oil is declining. That means a lot of substitutes are coming up. It is simple economic principle that price of one commodity goes up, and it becomes unviable to produce more and more of that commodity, then we'll have to definitely find an alternative source.
And what if you don't?
No, it's not possible. It never happened.
That's an economic desire.
Yeah.
But what if you don't? So the desire of economics is to find a replacement.
See, for instance, we are now depending on biofuel.
So and biofuel,
yeah.
This is what I'm trying to tell you. Biofuel is a net energy deficit. We are only doing biofuel at a huge cost to the environment. In other words, we are deciding to feed our cars and starve our people, which is a huge social cost, and it will manifest itself in wars and starvation, so let's put that aside. But the amount of energy which goes into growing the crop and then converting it to a very, very, not such a high quality fuel, what's called energy returned on energy invested is marginal. Your marginal benefit that you get is very small. So it is only an illusion for people. It's more of a publicity campaign that biofuels are some kind of a blessing. Biofuels are serving, it's only a desperation why we are doing biofuels, because your world runs on liquid fuels. So you'll do anything. You'll even starve half of South America to create that liquid fuel to run the cars in New York. So biofuel is no answer. It is one of the insanities that people are propagating. One of the absolute insanities that people are propagating. Just because we put bio before it, we think it's harmless. The prefix of bio does not make it harmless. It is even worthless as an energy source. It's an energy conversion. You're spending a huge amount of fossil fuel energy and thereby creating global warming too, and creating a low-grade biofuel at an at net energy. 1.29 or 1.3 is to 1 is your energy return on energy invested. Civilizations, the more complex a civilization is, the agrarian, you know, you need an energy return on energy invested of 10 is to 1. The more complex a society is, you need an energy source where you put in one unit and get 10 units out. Then the complex system works. An agrarian system used to work on 3 is to 1. We are not an agrarian world anymore. We are we have traffic lights, we have this, we have that, we have cables, we have sewage. We have so much other infrastructure which is energy dependent that to run this infrastructure, you need an energy return on energy invested. This is a study. 10 is to 1 is the energy return on energy. That means, you know, when you drill an oil well, earlier in America, when they used to drill an oil well, they used to put in one barrel. Supposing they spent one barrel to drill, they should get 100 barrels out. So EROEI was 100 is to 1. Then it fell 80, 75, 60, 50, 40. Today, it's almost 10 or 6 is to 1, depending on where you are. Our industrial society wobbles at that EROEI. So these are the principles that need to be considered. These are energy laws. It was very hopeful for economics to think that we'll find something else. There are certain limits to the universe. Our wishful thinking is not going to get it. Our wishful thinking is not going to get you something else. And then this gentleman here mentioned technology. Have you ever understood what technology is? Technology takes a phenomenal amount of energy to make. There's a tremendous amount of embedded energy in this. When you have a lot of cheap energy, you come up with technology like this. The moment that energy becomes expensive, you'll not be able to make this. This does not create energy. Energy creates this. And technology is a game extender. You're saying that with fracking, we have managed to get more. You haven't managed to get more. You're only extending the game. That means you're pushing the can down the road. So instead of depleting here, you'll deplete here. That's all. But at a huge loss. Fracking today is killing whole communities. We are not even interested in that because they're not fracking under our feet. The moment they come into your area and frack under your house, you will stand up and say, I will not allow this. It poisons your water. Please watch a movie, a documentary called Gasland. You open your tap, you put a match, it explodes. Your groundwater has been fed with the gas because you shatter the rock. Would you like to shatter your bones to get some extra energy out of your bones? You would never do it. But that's what we are doing with the earth. We are saying this is just a bone. Let's shatter this rock. So we are not even factoring. Tomorrow there'll be departments in universities saying, how did we ever allow this? You'll have whole departments coming up and we'll say, look, this is growth. See how many departments we have. We measure growth in a completely wrong way. So the question is, to answer the earlier gentleman's question, Malthus was not wrong. Malthus was assuming that we are gentlemen. He was saying if you continue the same way doing agriculture, which agriculture is linear and population is exponential, if you continue in the same gentlemanly fashion of doing agriculture, you'll be in trouble. He never imagined that we would become exponential in our agriculture by brutal means, by cutting our rainforest, by cutting our forest, by taking water from... We went intensive. So we made our food production exponential, which is an unhealthy sign. We did it unnaturally. Malthus was not expecting that. So that is the only mistake Malthus made, was he didn't realize how criminal we were, to what degree we were willing to change the rules to solve the problem. But that happens only for some time. Sooner or later, Malthus will be right. It is just that we've extended the game, and in a very dangerous way. What Malthus was saying, that if you continue doing this, this is madness anyway. What we did was we went exponential. And let me tell you one more thing. Population is a cause of surplus food. We are not growing more food because we have more population. We get more population because we grow more food. Please read ecology. In ecology, any species is dependent, the population is dependent on the food available. So we unnaturally grew more food. Agriculture is the first deviation from nature. We unnaturally grew more food and exponentially, first by monocropping, irrigation, chemicals, genetically modified, and we have followed this pattern, and population has followed the pattern in sync with it. like those two curves. You wanted money to grow like this, you used energy like this. We wanted food to grow like this, we made food a commodity. When you make food grow like this, your population goes like this. You grow food like this, your population will fall like that. Population follows food available in an ecological system. It is not the other way around.